Can you see my slides?
Yes, we can.
Good morning, Dr. Jatial, Dr. Namrita, Dr. Chitra, and all the panelists. I think in the next 10 minutes, I'll delve directly into the diagnosis and management of bacterial keratitis. I guess there might be a slight overlap with the contents of the earlier two speakers because they're all related subjects we are talking about right now. Do not have any financial interest in the mention of any products or procedures during the course of my talk here. So what a postgraduate needs to note when you're dealing with bacterial keratitis, we'll just go take it on point-wise, is the diagnostics. What is the clinical diagnostics? What are the conventional diagnostic methods you need to apply? And what are the newer diagnostic methods which you are probably going to look at in the recent advancements here? When you talk about medical management, you need to know all the aspects which are involved in the medical management of a bacterial ulcer. How would you go about the choice of an antimicrobial therapy? And a common question which is asked is, how would you choose monotherapy versus a combination therapy in the management of bacterial keratitis? What are the indications for oral antibiotics? And what's the role of topical steroids in the management of bacterial keratitis here? The next point to be considered is what is the indications for taking the patient on for a surgical intervention? What are the various options for surgical interventions? And of course, now on the anvil, we do have collagen cross-linking, which is also a non-pharmacological therapeutic option, which is used in management of recalcitrant ulcers here. Nikhil covered this very nicely here. So in a good history taking, what you need to cover is all the exogenous local factors, the endogenous local factors, and the systemic risk factors, which I have sort of put it on a crowded slide here for the benefit of the postgraduates here to know that you would have to elicit a history of contact lens wear, drug abuse with topical steroids, NSAIDs, prolonged use of anti-glaucoma medications, topical antibiotics here, ocular trauma or preceding ocular surgery, any lid disorders, lid deformities, trichiasis, lag of thalamus, lacrimal problems, dry eye, conjunctival problems, allergic problems, corneal conditions, all these can predispose to an occurrence of bacterial keratitis here. The systemic conditions, the ones to be noted, would be, of course, an uncontrolled diabetic here, debilitating illnesses, immunocompromised states, chronic alcoholism, patients who are in intensive care under coma, connective tissue disorders, dermatological diseases, mucous membrane diseases, and cranial nerve lesions here, and of course, graft versus host disease. So this is sort of a comprehensive, exhaustive list which a postgraduate needs to keep in mind when you're doing an eliciting history in a case of bacterial keratitis here. Clinical diagnosis, apart from history, the salient symptoms and signs, of course, has already been elaborated: pain, blepharospasm, photophobia, redness, blurred vision, discharge, corneal infiltrates, ulceration, and anterior chamber inflammation. A detailed clinical examination by slit lamp and documentation, either with a hand-drawn diagram or clinical photography during the course of follow-up, is going to go a long way in managing these ulcers well here and seeing how they are progressing or worsening. And what do you have to monitor when you're looking at treatment response in these patients is how is the pain quotient behaving? How is the discharge? Is there regression of the corneal edema and the surrounding infiltrates, the conjunctival hyperemia, the epithelial defect healing, and the depth of the stromal infiltrates and the anterior chamber reaction? So these are factors which one needs to look into. A quick look at the various clinical pictures of the commonly seen corneal ulcerations. So staphylococcal ulcers here, commonly usually round, well-circumscribed, well-defined ulcers with the surrounding cornea being clear here, of course, associated with acute pain here and a rapid onset with blurring of vision here. You can also have staphylococcal ulcers presenting as ring infiltrates as against not classically only Pseudomonas ulcers here. So that's something which postgraduates need to keep in mind. Again, all staphylococcal ulcers need not be infective ulcers. You can also have the exotoxin, staphylococcal exotoxin producing immune ulcers in chronic lid conditions as shown here. So those will need to be differentiated when you're talking about infectious keratitis. I think subsequent speakers will touch upon those differentiating features here. A streptococcal ulcer classically will be a serpiginous ulcer. You'll have one progressing edge and one leading edge, which would spread on to the surface of the cornea here. Nocardia has a characteristic wreath of pearl appearance. Pseudomonas ulcers, they are sort of grayish or yellowish greenish looking ulcers with copious purulent discharge, very rapid onset, rapid corneal and stromal melts here, a ground glass appearance here, and the surrounding cornea will be edematous and not clear as compared to a staphylococcus or a streptococcal ulcer, which will be a very classical differentiating description. I think one of the attendees wanted to hear on this earlier, and Nikhil did explain this again. Atypical mycobacteria here, you would have a cracked windshield appearance here. And to mention here, this, as was already described, when a patient is probably going doctor shopping and goes to several centers, these textbook picture is generally lost with the use of several medications. And you might not be really able to capture on these typical looks unless and until you're the first contact physician, which is looking at the ulcer here. I think we've already looked at how you have to do a corneal scraping. This is a post-refractive surgery, a post-LASIK corneal ulcer here. You need to do a flap lift in such cases. And of course, what is traditionally described is a Kimura spatula, but you could use any simple 26 gauge or a 30 gauge needle and scrape off from the region of the infiltrate. Remember to remove the necrotic material and do not send the necrotic material, which would only yield pus cells and will not give you any yield on microbial organisms here. You will have to scrape out from the region of the infiltrate here. You could use separate needles as you're plating onto different plates for smears and for your culture. And direct inoculations always is very helpful in such cases here. And when you probably are not able to get a culture positivity, as Dr. Namrata rightly pointed out, you could use a suture driven through the depth of the infiltrate here and sent over for a culture. Or alternatively, corneal biopsies can also be very important for identifying, especially in cases of one-eyed and in patients where you're not able to identify and they are worsening in conditions. So when are staining and corneal scraping culture sensitivity indicated here? When the infiltrate is very large, centrally located with stromal melts here, the infection is not responsive to your management here, the previous history of corneal surgery here, and there are multiple organisms involved and multifocal. Of course, the dictum would always be a scraping and a staining and scraping is probably indicated in all cases. And as rightly pointed out by Lalitha earlier, you would find that 60 to 75% of the time your gram stain, Giemser stain will be able to identify in the bacterial organism and it give you a positivity in most of the with your smear detection here. Gram stains will help you to identify the type of bacteria, will help you differentiate from if it is fungi or acanthamoeba. Giemser again will be providing you the same details, will also be able to delineate the detail of the inflammatory reaction which you're having in these patients, and acid fast staining will help to take out mycobacteria and nocardia here. So a few pictures which I think Lalitha herself had shown very nicely here, and I think I will just skip through them fast because that would sort of become a repetition here. And if you have time, probably you can look at them in the recordings earlier. Another common question which is asked for most postgraduates is what are the organisms that can penetrate the intact corneal epithelium? So we all know it's the Corneobacterium diphtheria, Haemophilus, Neisseria gonorrhoeae and meningitis and the Listeria species. Common organisms, bacteria which affect are the Staph, Strepto, Pseudomonas, which are very common, and lesser common are the Listeria moraxella species here. Streptococcal viridans infections are most common following corneal trauma, following filtering bleb infections, and in case of sac infections here. Nocardia is a partial atypical acid fast bacteria here and might mimic a fungal ulcer here. So that's when you need to be in caution, and is typically suspected when you have injury with infected water pools or swimming pools here. You would keep your nocardia in mind here. So culture sensitivity, again, you do corneal scrapings, which could be diagnostics for evaluating the kind of organism which is causing you the infection. And it can be therapeutic when you probably have to do it repeatedly to debride the drug deposits and debulk the infective material so that the amount of drug which is getting absorbed is much better here. So for smear detections, culture inoculations, and of course, antibiotic sensitivity testing is today playing a very important role in the management of bacterial keratitis, considering that over 30% of the cases are showing increased resistance to fluoroquinolones and most of the other antibiotics which we are using here. culture media, again, I think Blood Agar, Chocolate Agar, Lovenstein Jensen's Medium, and Infusion Broths. Blood Agar is for aerobic and facultative anaerobic, Pseudomonas, Staphylococcus species, Streptococcus. Chocolate Agar is for Haemophilus influenza, Neisseria, Bartonella. Lovenstein's LJ Medium for Mycobacteria and Nocardia here. So that's something baseline, which I think it's just sort of revising your microbiology earlier. And Lalita already described to you the Jones criteria for the diagnosis for a bacterial keratitis here. So today what I'd just like to touch upon is that antibiotic sensitivity is playing a very, very important role. And when culture sensitivity, the traditional culture and dish diffusion methods needs or delays about 48 hours in giving you a diagnosis. Rapid diagnostic methods such as PCR and the PNA FISH techniques are now evolving. And I think Lalita beautifully explained these to you as well. Confocal microscopy in bacterial keratitis is probably just going to identify the inflammatory reaction for you and will be able to differentiate it from an acanthamoeba or from a fungal keratitis here. Corneal biopsy with the skin trephines, dermatological trephines will again help. What is new in diagnostics is the use of anterior segment OCT here in cases where there's extensive corneal thinning, impending perforations, and to see the delimitation and also decide if you want to take them on for an early therapeutic deep anterior level keratoplasty. Once the inflammation and infection is contained to a particular level and is well managed with the fortified antibiotic therapy. What are the factors you will need to put in when you are looking at the antibiotic choice is whether it is a broad spectrum coverage, the availability to the patient, the cost, the toxicity of the medication, region-specific epidemiology, and the resistant patterns of the particular organism to the antibiotic you need to know is what is important in the judgment or decision-making here. Medical therapy will cover appropriate antibiotics, anticholinergics, and adjuvant therapy here. So I think I'll just cut short this and stop it out here and take up, just show this one last slide here where you have the gram-positive rods, what would you give, cephalosporins, your fluoroquinolones, aminoglycosides, and the newer anvils which you have on portal when they are drug-resistant bacterial keratitis will be linezolid, colicin, and imipenem. I think with this, we will stop here and we'll take on more questions or we'll discuss them later.